Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Health, Aging, Insurance Conference Committee. I think to start off, I will introduce the folks on the Assembly side, and then Senator Hannan will do the same on his side. We have on the Assembly side, our members Kevin Cahill, Donald Lepardo, Maritza Davila, our two alternates, Kimberly Jean-Pierre, and Rebecca Seawright, and the ranking minority member on the Health Committee, Andy Rea, if you want to.
Thank you, Chairman. My alternate is Dan Steck.
Okay, and just one procedural piece of business to get done before I forget. For the Assembly, Matt Richmond will be our recording secretary.
Thank you. Good morning. In regard to the members of the Senate who are on the conference committee, myself as co-chair, David Valesky, William Larkin, Sue Serino, Gustavo Rivera, Martin Golden, and Roxanne Persaud. I would like to appoint for the Senate Recording Secretary Samran Ali, and we obviously have a very short time to deal with all of the issues before us, and I'm going to have some comments about the substance, but I am most concerned that given the short amount of time, given the time we've lost because of snow days, and given the fact both houses would want to have a budget concluded in time for observance of both Passover and Easter, there's about a week and a half to do all of this. And so one of the issues I have is not with our counterparts in the Assembly, but rather with the pace that is usually set by the Division of Budget. In order to have real discussions, they need to be really there. Unfortunately, I don't find that the pace shows any sense of the lack of time. I went over with our finance staff and council staff a little while ago what the meetings are that are set, and find that we're dealing with relatively small items for the next 2 days, and it's not until Saturday that discussions and negotiations begin on obviously the important items. And I also think that the way that we've always done things, do it by budget parts, is not going to advance anything at all, because you needed to do it by topics and not by budget parts. You need to have meetings that have a fixed time that is not canceled. You needed to do it at times when people are available. The executive has an army of people to negotiate. We have both sides, both houses, some very talented folks, but they can only be in so many places at once. So there needs to be a sense of urgency that I don't find being brought forward. And so that's a real message to the Division of Budget, if they want to get a budget done on time. Preliminary discussions with some of my colleagues in the Assembly, the usual rule of, well, we'll just have to face a continuing resolution, doesn't work, because you can't enact taxes by a continuing resolution. You can't change conversion statutes by a resolution. All of it requires affirmative act of the legislature. We're very willing to discuss all aspects of a budget to try to get health care for New Yorkers, but it's going to require a change of attitude. So that's my opening comments. Come back to something of substance later, but Richard, do you want to go through your thoughts on policy matters instead of my diatribe?
Well, No, I think you have certainly raised very legitimate and important concerns, and you know, there are real mechanical and human and process considerations that need to be focused on in order for work to be done on time and with thought and care. Otherwise, things may not get done in time, or they may get done without an appropriate level of care to make sure that serious mistakes are not made. I mean, in some previous budget negotiations, we have discovered afterwards that I don't think we've lately found major glitches in the way things were written, but glitches and things that, at least to the people directly involved, were major. And so I think there are very serious and legitimate concerns that Senator Hannan has raised. I would like to, and I guess in some ways, well, what I would like to do is run through some of the major things where about the Assembly's One House proposal and things we've accepted and rejected and modified. And I think that does relate to the question of the complexity and time that's going to be needed to resolve these issues. You know, we have proposed funding through Medicaid to restore trend factors for a broad range of providers, hospitals, nursing homes, community health centers, home care, et cetera. You could say it's all the providers that that have an article in front of their name. The shortfall fund that the governor has proposed, we agree that we should be laying that money aside with a couple of modifications. Number one, it should not be available as it is in the current appropriation for any and all purposes that the governor and the director of the budget choose. And secondly, in our proposal, it needs to be subject to annual appropriation and a governor, assembly, and Senate MOU. The governor's budget proposes to lump together a series of public health and disease-specific programs, and then to cut that lump by 20%. We propose to restore the itemizing and the fund levels. On disproportionate share funding, we propose creating a multi-party work group to work on revising the mechanisms by which we distribute that money, particularly in anticipation or in response to possible federal changes. The spending of indigent care money, we add to the proposal in the budget a specific definition of enhanced safety net hospitals using the definition that the Assembly and Senate have passed 2 years in a row. In the area of pharmacy, we do a couple of things. One, we reject the various proposals from the executive about over-the-counter drugs and copays and the like, and propose legislation that would bring the prescription drug benefit back to the Medicaid program directly, not carving it out to various Medicaid managed care plans. I've always thought that that was the sensible thing to do, and I think the fact that the executive branch seems to have accepted the wisdom of that by having mechanisms in which the health department would take over negotiating with drug companies after the managed care plans have done their negotiating, I think argues for what we're proposing. We are rejecting the governor's proposal to limit reserve funds for not-for-profit Medicaid managed care plans. In the area of capital funding, we would increase the total number by 100 million. We would increase the pool for community-based facilities by 15 million, taking that up to 75 million, and move the assisted living program capital funding so that it doesn't use up community-based organization funding, but comes out of the general pool. Speaking of assisted living programs, we would accept the governor's proposal to add beds in the next couple of years, but also beyond that, create a system for the Public Health and Health Planning Council doing additional ALP bed applications based on a need methodology. In the area of long-term care, which has a variety of proposals in the governor's budget, we are proposing to reject the proposal on setting a numerical score under the uniform assessment tool in order to be part of a managed long-term care program. We are rejecting the governor's proposal to set a 10 limit on how many licensed home care agencies a Medicaid managed long-term care plan can work with, and instead we would deal with the problem or the phenomenon of the very large number of licensed agencies by suspending for a year the granting of new licenses by the Public Health and Health Planning Council, require FPIC to come up with a methodology for based on community need for granting licenses after that period runs out, and require that licensed agency licenses in the future be based on a finding of community need. We would provide in statute for creating a high-need rate cell for MLTCs to better accommodate the care and needs of those high-need patients. The governor had proposed that if you are to use the term in the current law, permanent resident of a nursing home, and you are there for more than 6 months, the governor proposed that you be disenrolled from the managed long-term care plan that you had been in before you entered the nursing home. We would, on the one hand, shorten that period to 3 months, which we think makes more sense in terms of evaluation timetables for evaluating patients, but secondly, instead of removing you from your managed long-term care plan, we would suspend your membership so that if and when you are ready to return to your home or to the community, you would not have to go through a re-enrollment process with an MLTC. We propose in the area of telehealth, the governor has proposed to broaden the sites where telehealth can be used in the Medicaid program. We think that makes sense, but we think the way to do it is to simply adopt for Medicaid the general and broad language that now applies to the health coverage that the rest of us use. In early intervention, we propose to remove insurance companies from the role of paying for EI services on a case-by-case basis, either paying or refusing to pay. Instead, they would make a lump sum payment of $25 million a year, which is roughly what we get from the insurance industry today for EI claims, but it would come through a bump up in the so-called covered lives assessment rather than one claim at a time. We would accept the proposed rate increase for EI providers, but reject all the other proposals for changes in how providers deal with insurance companies and the other language changes the governor had proposed. We agree with the governor's proposal to create a maternity mortality review board. We put in some modifications to some of the language, including much more formal recognition of the role of any local mortality review board that is created, particularly the New York City board, which is already up and running. In the area of ambulance care services, we accept the governor's proposed rate increase, but reject the proposal, the governor's proposals to eliminate the supplemental rate and rural rate add-ons. Last thing I want to mention is, you know, every year in the budget there are a variety of specific organizations or programs that the legislature provides funding for. At this point in the process, it is difficult, if not impossible, to say much about what we will do in that area because we don't yet know what our so-called table target will be. Certainly our goal, which I think the Senate shares, is to restore the funding that we have done in the past, and to the extent we are able, go beyond that. That's what I have to say at this point.
Thank you. I'd like to call upon Senator Susan Cirino.
Thank you, Senator Hannan. Sorry. My part of the discussion is about Lyme disease. As you know, I chair the Lyme Task Force for the Senate, and it was really disappointing to not have money in the executive's budget. So I was very happy when Senator Hannan and we worked to put $1.2 million in, which is so critical. I know everyone in this room either knows someone or has actually been affected by Lyme disease, and now we're experiencing the other co-infections and Powassan where there have actually been deaths. So it's so critical to have the dollars for research and education. You know, the first couple of years we were able to put money, $600,000 in the budget, which when you think of the size of our budget, that's minuscule. Last year it was $400,000, but because of our investment for the first 2 years, the Cohen Foundation, which would be considered a public-private partnership, donated $5 million to the Carey Institute. People want to see that we're making that investment. Stony Brook on Long Island has done amazing research, and we need to continue to do that. I think of people that come into my office that are crippled from Lyme disease, and they're not getting any help. My own brother died by suicide, and we don't know if it part of it was that he was misdiagnosed with Lyme for 8 years. We have a bill in that would actually study that after someone's death. But it's so critically important, and I hope that at the end of the day, we're able to all come together and provide this critical funding. And I thank Senator Hannan for all of his hard work with us on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Kevin, you want to talk about insurance issues?
Thanks, Dick. Thanks, Senators. Good to see you here again. Hopefully we see each other a couple of times and then get it done a little bit early this year. That would be a good goal. I think we all share that. Let me give you a few updates on where the Assembly stands on some insurance issues. Dick mentioned the shortfall fund, and by reference, the conversion. We have not changed dramatically the language that the governor included in his executive budget, but we agree that it's something that warrants great consideration before we get to the end of the line on that, and that the resources that are derived from that conversion should be specifically and exclusively dedicated to health purposes. The Assembly rejects the 14% tax on health insurance. The Assembly provides $433.37 million in all funds appropriation, which is an increase of $65,000 from the executive. That $65,000 is specifically a restoration to the Entertainment Workers Demonstration Program for one additional year to bring a total to that program of $100,000. We accept the executive's proposal with no changes on state operations. We reject the increased fines that were being proposed for DFS to administer for all health insurers. We add language prohibiting insurers from requiring insureds to use mail orders if a local pharmacy agrees to the same reimbursement rate. We include the Comprehensive Contraceptive Care Act language that was passed by the Assembly earlier this week as part of our budget proposal. Dick mentioned early intervention. We would be assuming the state and local share fully funded under the covered lives assessment. We would be rejecting the fines that in part were being levied against those companies. We would reject the structural changes and to claims processing. And we would be, once and for all, finally taking the providers out of the loop so that they can get back to providing services for kids and not become bill collectors. And we have included in our proposal coverage for in vitro fertilization.
Okay. Ms. Lopardo, do you want to talk about the aging?
Yeah. Thank you, Dick. Sure, I'll provide a few highlights from the Assembly's One House on the aging budget. Of note, we are providing appropriation of $4 million to support the naturally occurring retirement communities and neighborhood NORC programs. It should be noted that we are trying to find a way to spend the $2 million in mortgage insurance fund money, which was allocated in last year's budget, as well as a new $2 million appropriation for this year, again, from the Mortgage Insurance Fund. The Assembly restored $500,000 in funding for the Community Services for the Elderly program, and I'm happy to report that the Senate did the same for $1 million addition. I would be remiss to not mention the fact that given the thousands of seniors who are on waiting lists across the state, and our sincere intention to help seniors stay at home for as long as possible to age in place or to age in whatever place they want to age, we want to reiterate our commitment to finding additional funds for that in particular, for the community services for the elderly. But at least we have $1 million in new money there. The Assembly restores $400,000 in various support programs and services. For example, the Older Adults Technology Services Program. We're also putting back $86,000 in funding for New York Foundation for Senior Citizens Home Sharing and Respite Care Program, and a restoration of $32,000 for the New York Statewide Senior Action Council. We're all very committed to these issues, and I'm hoping for a timely resolution moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I personally am disappointed that in the bill that we're looking at, there is no funding for gun violence research as a healthcare issue. We're funding many programs because the issues that we're encountering, but in our communities, gun violence is an epidemic, and we need to have some funding in there for the research. I'd urge my colleagues to please carefully look at that. I'd love us to fund fully the school-based healthcare clinics that we have in my district. I have a number of them. My colleagues in Kings County have a number of them. We'd like to have the consolidation of the public health programs, the consolidation rejected. We'd like to have the deferral, the COLA referral rejected also. We're looking at be fair to direct care when we're talking about healthcare issues. So there are many things within the budget that we'd like to see looked at. We want to make sure that we're funding the women's agenda. We were not really talking about that, but we really have to. We must fund lead remediation for NYCHA is a healthcare issue. So when we're looking at that, we need to ensure that in our healthcare budget that we're looking at that lead remediation. It affects many of us. Many of us have many developments with this issue, and I'd like to see us funding that so that we can take care of our kids who, when they're living with lead, it's a long-term issue. It's not, so we have to look at, it's a major issue. The same way we're looking at other healthcare issues, we must look at the lead issue in NYCHA. Again, our senior programs, the health programs, we have to fund that, look at the funding for that. We tend to, when we're cutting, we tend to look at the most vulnerable in our population, and it's usually the seniors and the youth. We have to stop doing that. So again, I'd like my colleagues to please look at restoring funding, senior programs, lead remediation in NYCHA, amongst the other things I've talked about. And most importantly, we must fund gun violence research as a health care issue across the state of New York. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Rea, do you?
Yes, please. Thank you, Chairman. When it comes to the overall budget process, we realize that we in the Assembly minority don't have a whole lot of control over the timing of things. That being said, we feel it is appropriate that both minority leaders in the Senate and the Assembly should be included in that process, which would also help streamline debate on the floor. When it comes to specifics in the budget, the Assembly minority agrees with the Senate's plan to completely eliminate the opioid surcharge. We also support the Senate's budget process with respects to the full implementation of electronic death registries for funeral directors within 60 days. We support both houses, both majorities when it comes to the elimination of nurse anesthetists with respects to Medicaid. We accept both houses with proposals with respects to the, we accept the Senate's proposal with respects to the 2% tax on poor performing nursing homes. We call for a complete elimination on that. When it comes to LHCSAs, licensed home care service agencies, we do have concern about the Assembly majority's proposal that would create a one-year moratorium that does not exempt private pay. So whatever process, agreement is reached on that issue, we would encourage that private pay not be affected, because that does help create jobs and monies for the economy. When it comes to telehealth, both sides have vastly different proposals. Whichever proposal gets eventually worked out, we would hope that there will be a uniform process for anybody to follow with respects to DOH, OASIS, OMH, and OPWDD. Right now, they all require different things and a different process, and if we're going to streamline things and make them more effective, we should certainly have an eye towards that. This past Monday, the Assembly minority advanced a proposal that would take over the local share of Medicaid from local governments. We are one of 18 states that require a contribution from our local governments. This proposal is robust and well thought out. It does not make cuts to any services or any reductions in optional services, and spreads out the implementation over a period of 10 to 20 years so we can properly plan. It's time that we do what we can to help our local governments stay within the tax cap. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Serino, you wanted to address the aging issues since you chair that committee?
Yes, thanks, Senator Hannon. And I wanted to say thank you to Assemblywoman Donna Lopardo for fighting also for our seniors with the CSE, the Community Services for the Elderly, because this funding will allow our seniors to age in place and provide respite for caretakers. And I know we've heard that there's some differences in opinion with regard to how many people are on the wait list at our health hearing. They were reported that there were over 20,000 seniors. I was encouraged also in our budget hearing that we have budget language for the Elder Abuse Hotline was included. I sponsored this legislation with Assemblywoman Lopardo, and the governor's expressed support for it. I also want to be put on the record that we need to be fighting for dollars to make this a reality. This is so important. Right now we have the Adult Protective Services line, but it's only there 9 to 5. What happens after hours? We have the Child Abuse Hotline, which is so important as well. They're equally important. And we have to figure out what the dollar amount is to see what that will be. We heard disparities between $5 million and $14 million, but we're not recreating the wheel. We already have a system in place. It's just the additional hours. So I just want to be put on record that we really need to fight for that money for our seniors. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any other assembly members on the panel want to make remarks? Okay.
Senator Golden?
I want to commend the chairs for the good work that we're doing here today and trying to achieve the best healthcare system that we can here in the state of New York, which is not easy. And of course, coming from New York City itself, I know there's going to be a nice give and take over the next week in trying to accomplish that goal. We all want to do what's best, obviously, for our healthcare system, but making sure that our seniors and our nursing homes and our assisted living facilities don't fall between the cracks, it's important. Our ALPS, that we take care, make sure the right funding goes into those locations, into those, into that industry. Healthcare in Kings County, Brooklyn, I think everybody here knows it's ground zero. As the healthcare in Brooklyn goes, so does the healthcare here in the state, and I go a little bit further, the state of country. We have the highest Medicaid rolls. We have hospitals that are in flux. And Brooklyn One, obviously, is a design that's going to give us the ability to bring those hospitals back into where they should be, good health institutions moving forward. And the money that's necessary to do that, the $700 million that's gone down there this past year, is good and is in continuing to flow. But we probably need somewhere about $1.5 to $2 billion to make that a real solid healthcare system in Brooklyn One. We also have Luther Medical, Maimonides, Downstate, other hospitals there, Kings County. These hospitals have to be shored up to make sure that they have the funding for their capital as well as their operating dollars. And that's not easy in some of these institutions. Another going off to my good colleague, the Chair of Aging. I know that we NORCs are very important, especially since we have an aging population across this great city and across this great state. We need to be able to make sure that the aging population has the ability to have services. Right now, the NORC system, we've just done the present funding that we did last year. We need to get more funding into our NORCs. So we make the NORCs being in the natural occurring retirement communities that give the ability for our seniors to retire in those different, whether they be an open NORC, a closed NORC, a neighborhood NORC, whatever the NORCs may be. We need to make sure we got funding there so that our seniors can live comfortably going into their golden ages, no pun included. I want to again thank, nobody got that. Senator Golden, nobody got that. Somebody did. So I don't want to go on. I have another committee meeting going on public protection in the next room. Medicaid is obviously going to be an issue here for us at this table and making sure that we got the right money going into Medicaid and, of course, whatever the federal government does coming forward and how that impacts us. Hopefully, again, we're looking for the same goals, the Assembly, the Senate, and the governor, and that's to get the best health care system that we can and making sure the right money flows into the system so it does not become a broken system. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Senator. Well, then I have a few comments I'd like to add to the proceedings. The Senate is vitally interested in regard to a number of items that we introduced as new topics that were only tangentially addressed by the executive budget. First one would be in regard to what we've proposed for opioid and heroin. We think there is a need for a major addressing of this issue. The number of overdoses and deaths is totally staggering. just in the United States alone, in the last year of recorded statistics from 2015 to 2016, there was a 20% increase in deaths in the United States, mirrored by the proportionate increase in New York State. And when we're talking about the number of deaths, it's easy enough just to say the word deaths, but when you say it's 64,000, it's staggering. That was an increase from 52,000 the year before. And so we feel that there is a need for a multifaceted approach to the whole subject. We have proposed an extensive drug take-back program to get opioids out of the house when it's not needed, so it can't be misused. We have proposed a very extensive ombudsman program so that families who are trying to help people in the families steer through the complicated, the overly complicated system of getting rehabilitation can get assistance in that. We propose limiting the amount of script, the number of days of opioid strips, that's a prescription, to 3 days, reducing it from the current 7 days. We would work to set up a demonstration program in emergency departments of hospitals to reduce opioid use. We would require emergency rooms to contract the initial prescriber of opioids in the event a patient comes in for an overdose treatment, trying to complete the circle of attention to the individuals with addiction. We would deal with education for providers, for expectant moms. We would set up an infant recovery center for treating babies born in withdrawal. And we would also address the need to improve jail-based services. One of the primary areas where we know people are going to be subject to going back to using drugs. So that is a major, major initiative. Hardly touched. And even though I believe we ought to go into the criminal justice arena, because there is many things that need to be done where it's obvious the supply is part of a criminal organized program, what we have only put in our One House budget is dealing with non-criminal justice. So there is a big agenda to do. We've also addressed clean water, dealing with increasing the number of municipalities whose lead pipes are treated, dealing with emergent contaminant contingency fund, as we've asked that the Water Council establish minimum contaminant levels for new emerging contaminants. We feel that there may be impinging on water supply, and we would provide an emergency program for that. We would direct funding from the Environmental Protection Fund to a laboratory testing facility for PFOA and other contaminant chemicals. We would increase the public access and attention that the governor proposed in regard to those areas, those lakes that have algae on them and endangering the use of those lakes for water. The lead response, we have included New York's City Housing Authority oversight in our TED bill, not necessarily the health bill. We would bolster and make sure that there's people who attend the Council on Lead Poisoning Prevention. We would give schools outside of New York City access to information on blood levels. We would make sure that lead blood screening is required by having the check done as early as kindergarten. And we've talked about Lyme disease. We've had hearings on that. Major needs for work in regard to diagnosis and treatment on that. We've also made proposals on rape kits because we feel that too little has been done in that area. We've passed legislation on that. Now it's a question of making sure that the storage of those kits is improved, is continued. Currently it's 5 days. Governor proposed going to 5 years. We propose going to 20 years, feeling that finding people who are attacking women is absolutely necessary, and the evidence that is preserved in a central location, so it's not just in a hospital where, with everything else that goes on in hospitals, it's not a priority. Well, telehealth, we have welcomed that the governor has finally changed, the executive has finally changed their position. It had been our original position that we should have a wider source of where the telehealth services can begin. And then I would also note that we've included something that Assemblyman Rea noted, that there should be uniformity in rules and regulations about the use of telehealth, so that as you go from one agency to the next, you don't find confusing rules that sometimes contradict each other or overlap. So we feel that these are necessary things to do. We have rejected all the taxes that are there, recognize that much of what this budget and the accomplishments we'll have in health will depend on questions of revenue that come into the state, but those are not necessarily within our pay grade. And the only comment I have left is in regard to the LICSs. The executive had proposed limiting the amount of the number of LICSs that a managed long-term care company could contract with to 10. We have set forth some target numbers in our budget resolution. We know there are negotiating points. We feel that this is something that the legislature should be totally involved in, leaving it as the assembly does to the Public Health Council, otherwise named by Assemblyman Gottfried as PIFIC, would not be productive, because they've had a chance to look at the number of new certificates of needs that they've been entertaining over the years. We propose a moratorium, but if we're going to take a look at how to rationally and compassionately reduce the number of LICSs, we think the legislature should have a strong voice. So those are just some of the things that are on our mind, and I thank you, Mr. Co-Chair, and I thank you, members of the committee.
Okay, I think we are almost ready to adjourn. I just want to clarify two things. Number one, on the question of the Public Health and Health Planning Council, commonly known as FIPIC, when the name change was first enacted, I suggested that we could treat the H as silent, in which case it would be pronounced PUPIC, which is Yiddish for belly button. But I would note that idea never caught on. And I just, one
thankfully,
final thought is that as I was coming in, I don't know what the meeting is in the adjoining hearing room, but as I was coming in, there were periodic bursts of wild applause. And, you know, you folks just have to do better.
Well,
All right.
Aside from applause, I assume that we'll be hearing from each and every one of you about your own ideas, which is what the whole purpose of the conference committees are for, to be as markers where we are in the discussions and to let you know where we're going forward. I would think that, well, in past years, we've just left ourselves at the mercy of, well, we should, what's going on in the conference committee, when should we meet again, et cetera. I would have proposed meeting this weekend. When I said that to Assemblyman Gottfried before we commenced, his eyes really just totally were taken aback. So I would think that we should be meeting on Monday as a conference committee, not that it has to be a long meeting. There might be some items that are worthy of discussion that you've heard some differences, but I think we're gonna have to move this forward, and it needs to be done on an accelerated basis. We have an obligation to get the budget done on time, and we can do that. And so I'm looking forward to further hard work with you guys.
Okay, we'll see whether further meetings hasten the process. We will be talking about that. So stay tuned.
Thank you.
And with that, I think we're adjourned.